3.4 consultations per year compared to 14 consultations per year is for chronic migraine. So people with chronic migraine will keep coming back to you. So if somebody keep coming back to you, it's chronic migraine. Okay, so as I just mentioned that once you made a diagnosis of chronic migraine, it's not just about giving them prophylaxis. It's about finding out the comorbidities. They may have a chronic low back pain, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, low back pain, anxiety, depression. Treat all those things. Try and identify some more triggers. Triggers are very difficult. One in 100 people would come to me and say, I get headache when I eat chocolate. And it's very easy to say that don't eat chocolate if you get a headache with that. But vast majority would not be able to identify what causes their migraine. And this is because migraine is about genes. You have a genetic tendency, you've inherited the gene from your parents, you have migraine. You have a low threshold to respond to trigger factors. And the trigger factors could be hundreds of them. Could be diet, it could be weather, it could be hormones, it could be stress, your blood glucose level, your eating patterns, your sleeping patterns. So the main thing is to try and push your threshold higher up rather than finding out the individual trigger factors, because in vast majority you would not be able to find a particular trigger factor unless they have got one or two particular ones that they have identified themselves. Okay, so I've touched on it that some people think that if you have a medication overuse problem with chronic migraine, you tackle the medication overuse headache first and then deal with chronic migraine with prophylaxis. Some people say no, it's the other way around. But all the evidence suggests that it doesn't matter. If people have medication overuse problem, it's quite likely that they have chronic migraine and medication overuse is secondary to chronic migraine. It is very unlikely that they have a medication overuse headache, purely medication overuse headache. As I said, there is a difference between medication overuse and medication overuse headache. So if you look at the data from the Chris Diener study in Germany, people who have medication overuse problem, if you give them topiramate to daily headaches with or without medication overuse, they both respond very well. If you look at the data from our Botox cohort of patients, it makes no difference. So people who have overuse problem, if you give them Botox, they still get better. If they don't have a medication overuse problem, they'll get better as well. So this means that medication overuse is a secondary effect of chronic migraine. So you treat chronic migraine and they both would improve. Okay, so this is just the summary of the first part of the talk. I hope I have not taken longer. Chronic migraine, new daily persistent headache, hemicrania continua, and then if your headache patient does not fit into any of the three category, they may have chronic tension type headache. And how often do I see chronic tension type headache? Maybe one or two cases a year. And even those cases, I think I would be wrong. I think they probably would still have chronic migraine. So a good way of working on chronic daily headache, if people have chronic daily headache, I think this pointer is so weak that I can't project it. But anyway, so you've got chronic daily headache. If it is strictly unilateral, try endomethacin. Go towards hemicrania continua. If it has got a clear onset of action, then this is a new daily persistent headache. If it hasn't got hemicrania continua, new daily, treat it as chronic migraine. And if you are 100% sure that this is not migraine, and you have to be very brave. Right, so medication overuse headache, I've just touched into it, I'll very quickly go through it. Anything can give you chronic daily headache. People think paracetamol is very innocent, but paracetamol can still give you medication overuse. Simple analgesics and combination analgesics, and I know in the UK it's a big problem. Every painkiller that you buy in the supermarket will have codeine. Do you have the same here? No? Is codeine available separately?
Not available.
Not available? So that you don't have that problem here then, okay.
Now, codeine is available in the form of a tablet called Femidol Plus.
Okay.
They have got a combination drugs which contains caffeine and paracetamol and with codeine.
Okay. Because in the United States, the problem is most of the painkiller would have barbiturate and caffeine. In the UK, most of the painkiller you buy off the supermarket would have codeine. So that is why, so if you look at the data from Pakistan, you would not find this statistics correct, because half of the people would have combination analgesics. But that's because this was done in Europe. So if you do it in Asia, it will be different because you don't have codeine problem. Triptan, it's not a bad thing to overuse triptan, because you develop medication overuse problem more quickly, but you stop and within 5 or 6 days you'll get better. So it's easy to tackle triptan overuse. We don't really see a lot of ergotamine, but you have ergotamine still? Ergotamine in Pakistan? So what do you do when people have a medication overuse problem? Well, you can ask them to stop suddenly, or you can ask them to come off gradually. But I think the best thing would be to stop it suddenly, because it's like, you can't say that I'll smoke 10 cigarettes, then tomorrow I'll have 9, then 8, and then 7. You would never. You have to stop suddenly. You have to go cold turkey. So medication overuse, stop. You'll have some withdrawal symptoms for a few days, and then you start to get better. Do you start prevention treatment before stopping the treatment or after stopping the treatment? I think there is no consensus. Do you do it as an outpatient or as an inpatient? I think vast majority you'll do it as an outpatient. I think it would be difficult. Well, I think it's exactly the same in UK and Pakistan, because here you can buy over the chemist, there you can buy it over the supermarket. So medication overuse is a similar problem in both sets. So the main thing is that you get worse before you get better. So basically you have to tell people that you'll get worse before you improve, and depending upon what painkiller they take, it may take a little longer if it is not triptan. And vast majority would stay off the painkiller, but about half of them would relapse over a period of 5 years. Okay, some people suggest a role of steroid, but I think it's controversial. There are few papers suggest you give them a 2-week course of steroid, few papers suggest not, but I think it is still not a universal practice to give them steroid. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about what is the current recommendation on people in terms of prophylaxis, because I think this is the topic that has changed quite a bit over the last few years. It's for sure that if people get headaches for more than 6 days a month, they should be on some form of prophylactic treatment or prevention treatment. So what drugs we currently use? We use beta blockers, 5-HT blockers, pizotifin, methysergide, anti-epileptic drugs, topiramate, epilim, tricyclic antidepressant, ACE inhibitors, and angiotensin receptor. So these are the categories that you can use, are available to you. The one with the star doesn't have a license in the UK, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't work. There is another one that does work, which is not here, is flunarizine. And I saw a stand of Cybalium outside here, so that means it's available here. It's available all over Europe, but it's not available in the UK. Strange enough, but it's a very good drug anyway. So you start either tricyclic antidepressants or beta blockers as a first line treatment. NICE recommends that you use topiramate as a first line, but because of the side effects, you should try tricyclic and beta blockers first. If that fails to work, then you go on the second line. I tend to use candesartan as my preferred drug after the first three. Epilim, the effect is very, the evidence is very dodgy. So here in Pakistan, you can use flunarizine and candesartan as well on this side. Because we don't have it available, that's why I've put it in the UK on the right. Pizotifin, you'll put on weight. The evidence is very dodgy. It does work in kids, In teenagers, it works quite well, particularly those who are physically very active. So I think tricyclic beta blocker topiramate, candesartan flunarizine, and if it's a chronic migraine, Botox, all other drugs, you can use it if you are struggling. That's pisotrophin. Senomigraine, cyproheptadine, pisotrophin, they're same. Okay, so current NICE guidelines, which is obviously is practiced all over the world, NICE guidelines, apart from America, and they usually recommend topiramate, propranolol, and tricyclic as a first line, and they do recommend. You can see that gabapentin, which used to be recommended a few years ago, has been taken off by the guidelines. So if you have tried quite a few drugs, I suppose you have tried Botox as well, then greater occipital nerve block. And the way the greater occipital nerve block works is because I think the pain pathway goes through the greater and lesser occipital nerve into the trigeminal nucleus, which is a very long nucleus from midbrain, pons, medulla, and right up to C2, C3 level, trigeminal nucleus caudalis. And I think if you block the greater and lesser occipital nerve, there is a very good evidence that it can actually break the circuit of pain and may give them a temporary remission for a few weeks. So we do use greater occipital nerve block, particularly in high frequency migraine. But obviously, if it is a chronic migraine, then before you do the greater occipital nerve block, you use Botox. So currently, if people have chronic migraine, I don't know what is your practice in Pakistan, but in the UK, we are asked to try 3 drugs, and if they fail 3 drugs, then you can give them Botox, 2 treatments 3 months apart. If they don't respond to any of them, stop. If they do respond, you carry on giving them every 3 months until their headaches get a lot better, i.e. they become episodic. In America, if it's a chronic migraine, give Botox from the very start, because it's all reimbursement and insurance. It's not a National Health Service. So I think in Pakistan, because of the cost problem, you might want to try, well, it's a cost problem to the patient. In England, it's a cost problem to the government. In America, it's no cost problem, it's insurance. So I think the practice varies from where you are in the world. But I think if people don't respond to it in 2 injections 3 months apart, then don't give them Botox again. So we have the largest data in the world, in the UK, for Botox patients post-marketed. So the phase 4 or post-marketing data, and our data clearly indicates that about 65% of the people would show some kind of a response. So the data is very similar to what the double-blind randomized placebo-controlled trial data showed in 2010, which was the preempt data that made the Botox got a license. So in our data, as you can see, 66%, right at the far corner, 66% of the patients would show a response, which is very similar to what they found in the preempt study. We also found that if people have headaches between 20 and 25 days a month, tend to do well. If they have 15 to 20 days, they don't do as good as the one with 20 to 25 days. Similar people with 26 to 30 days don't do as very well. And that is probably because people who have got 26 to 30 days of headache may very well have medication overuse as the main problem, while those in the middle may have chronic migraine with medication overuse as a secondary phenomena. And as you've already seen, the medication overuse doesn't matter, so whether they have medication overuse problem or not, they do exactly the same, and the response is no different. So after Botox, what else? So I'm going to talk about few treatments that are available but are not funded in the UK because of the cost problem. I don't think they are available in Pakistan at all. You have gadgets? You have gadget. Sorry?
You have EMS
editing. You have. Are you using it? Okay. So there are few gadgets coming their way. Most of these gadgets have been recommended by NICE. NICE is the watchdog for National Health Service in the UK. And they are all approved by FDA, which is the watchdog for the United States. So they are very well recommended, but because of the cost issues, a lot of people in Europe and America are not using. America, they are using because it's a reimbursement and the cost is covered by the insurance companies. So what are these gadgets? So we're going to talk about three gadgets. One is TMS. So TMS is a device that gives you a little current if you apply at the back of your head. And it is thought to be that migraine comes when there is spreading depression in the occipital lobe. And if you try and disrupt the brain through the magnetic device, it stops the spreading depression and stops the migraine. That's the logic behind it. So it comes in the handbag. There is a new version which is much smaller than the old version. You apply it on the back of, if you look at the third picture, on the back of your head, press the button, it delivers the impulses. It disrupts the brain and stops propagation of the spreading depression and stops the migraine attack. So the Lipton study done in 2010 was the first randomized controlled data that showed that it was effective. We did a post-marketing pilot program and found out 62% of the people would respond to it. And as a matter of fact, recently we published that if you use the TMS instead of Botox in people with chronic migraine, it's actually less costly than Botox. Because obviously in Botox, you have to give two treatments before you find out whether it is working or not. But with the TMS, with the very first or second application, you'll know whether it is going to be effective or not. So it's much more cost effective. But I think in the UK, the NICE has recommended, but they are not funded. The second gadget is called GammaCore. So GammaCore is something that you apply to the right side of your neck. It is based on the principle that vagus nerve goes to link with the hypothalamus, and if you stimulate the vagus nerve, it would go and disturb the hypothalamus and switch off the migraine generator which comes out from the hypothalamus. And they have done studies on chronic migraine, cluster headache, episodic migraine. The chronic migraine study, which is not published yet but has been presented in the American Headache Society, clearly indicates that in people with chronic migraine, it would reduce quite significantly the number of headache days in using the vagus nerve stimulator compared to placebo or sham stimulation. There is also evidence in cluster headache from the PREVA study. It's PREVA, it's a typo. And in acute treatment of cluster headache, the ACT 1 study, they both showed quite significant improvement in people with the chronic and episodic cluster headache. At the moment, we're doing study in episodic migraine to see whether GammaCore would do anything to episodic migraine. This third gadget is called Cephali. It's like wearing your glasses over your forehead. So it stimulates the supraorbital and supratrochlear nerves, and it tends to stimulate the nerves and stop the pain signal coming out of the hypothalamus. Good randomized control data. About 2,000 patients were followed up on the open label study and post-marketing study. You can buy the device over the internet. Again, this is recommended by NICE but not funded, because obviously they all carry some cost. I think TMS in UK is about £150 a month. GammaCore is about £100 a month. And Cephali is about £150 to buy the buy the glasses or buy the device, and then you have to buy the electrode because you have to put electrode. So every time you buy the electrode, it's £20. So it's ongoing cost, and that is the main problem, cost issues. What else is new in terms of gadgets is SPG or sphenopalatine ganglion stimulation. So you implant a stimulator behind the gums in the sphenopalatine ganglion, and you have a remote control in your hand, so whenever you have a cluster headache, you stimulate the SPG through the remote control and your cluster headache would get better. So that this is now the fairly standard treatment for chronic intractable cluster headaches. That's something new, and I think this is replacing the ONS, which is the occipital nerve stimulator, that was initially quite popular. So that was the next one. So that's the occipital nerve stimulator. That's more invasive rather than like the TMS and others. They are very non-invasive. This is quite invasive, and now this is usually tried after you have tried the SPG or sphenopalatine ganglion stimulation. Okay, what's coming in the next few years? So I think the last few slides are for what's coming in the future. So one thing that would be coming would be the CGRP, which I'll talk a bit later, but there is another new treatment that would get into the market in the next 2 to 3 years would be the DITANs. You remember triptans? They are 5-HT1B1D agonist, yeah? And 5-HT1D1B has got an action on trigeminal ganglion and also coronary and other circulation. So they causes vasoconstriction. There is another receptor called 5-HT1F, which is purely located in trigeminal ganglion. So if you have a 5-HT1F agonist, you can have triptans, very similar to triptans, but no vasoconstriction. And currently, phase 3 trials are going on, particularly in people with one or more risk factor for cardiovascular disease. And I think probably by end of next year or early 2018, you will see the Lesme Dieton come out in the market. It's currently open label studies going on in a large cohort of patients. So that will be another addition. So that's just to show where 5-HT1B/D/F are located in the trigeminal vascular system. So the last few slides is for CGRP, and I think you probably all seen in Glasgow that half of the conference in Glasgow for migraine was on CGRP. And I think over the next 2 to 3 years, the next revolution that is going to come in migraine would be CGRP. Over the next 5 years, you'll have different treatments that would work on the CGRP molecule and would change the way migraine is treated. This would be the revolution 30 or 35 years after the triptan revolution that came on in early 90s. So be prepared for welcoming this revolution. Now, where does it all start? This is the current president, well, is the president-elect, Lars Edvinson on your left. And this is Peter Goadsby, who's just finished his IHS presidency about 2 years ago. And they both, in 1990, thought about CGRP. The first one to think about that CGRP could be the target for migraine. What happened is that they found out that people with migraine would have a high CGRP levels. People with migraineurs would have an increased level of CGRP in saliva. If you inject CGRP, it will give people migraine. And if you give them triptan, CGRP level go back to normal and stabilize it. They found out that there were alpha and beta subtypes, and the alpha subtype is the one which is linked with migraine because it's in the spinal and trigeminal ganglia. The other one, beta one, is not sure whether it is linked with migraine or not. There are cell bodies that have CGRP. They found out in hypothalamus, which is linked with triggering a migraine attack. it has got cell bodies in superior colliculus, which they think can cause photophobia and phonophobia. In inferior colliculus, brainstem, that can cause nausea or vomiting, and trigeminal complex, that can cause pain. So what happens in a migraine? You have spreading depression. The spreading depression would lead to vasoconstriction, and as soon as the vasoconstriction starts, the brain releases CGRP as a protective mechanism to cause vasodilatation. And the CGRP not only causes vasodilatation, but it also causes neurogenic inflammation, which is the aftermath of a migraine attack. So they tried to develop CGRP antagonist in the last 15 years. The first one to develop was Olcigepant. It was an IV preparation which worked quite well, but they couldn't really develop an oral formulation, so they gave it up. Then Merck developed the Telcigepant, but it was abandoned because it caused raised liver enzymes. But I think there is a new version of the Telcigepant still going on, so that would be another addition in the next couple of years that might come on. But I think most of the pharmaceutical industries change their targets to something else. So this is the data on Olcigepant, very good effect in people with migraine response compared to placebo. But as I say, that this was intravenous, not acceptable, and the Telcigepant was altered the liver enzymes. So most of the pharmaceutical company is now concentrating on antibodies, human antibodies, monoclonal antibodies against the CGRP molecule. And currently there are four companies which are pursuing the monoclonal antibodies. These treatments, if they are successful, which they will be, because if there was no room, no chances of success, four big pharmaceutical industries would not put a lot of money in. You give a subcut injection like you give insulin once a month, and in some cases once every 6 months. You inject yourself and then you'll be free from migraine for 6 months. Well, not totally free, but you'll have a 50% reduction in migraine. So wouldn't that be a good thing, rather than taking beta blockers or topiramate every day, or having injections of Botox every 3 months, 31 injections, one injection that you jab yourself and it will make you free for 3 to 6 months. So Amgen and Novartis has got the adalimumab. This would be the first one to be available, I think, beginning of 2018. They are putting their bid for approval to the FDA and MHRA later on in 2017. So adalimumab would be the one to look out for by early 2018, and then there are three more by Teva, Alders and Lilly. What else is going on? This is just a slide to show that migraine is not just about headache. Migraine starts long before the headache comes on. So people start to have some symptoms called premonitory symptoms 2 days, 3 days before the headache. They start to yawn, they start to feel unwell, they feel tired, they start to pass more urine, they have craving for certain kind of food. So that's called premonitory symptoms. Then they have headache with or without aura, and then after the migraine goes away, they still feel very unwell for a couple of days, what we call a postdrome. So the reason to put this slide is that there is a lot of research going on at the moment looking for what happens in the brain before the migraine starts and after the migraine comes to an end. And this is from one of the PET imaging studies that shows on your extreme left the areas that are activated in different parts of the brain about 1 to 2 days before the actual headache has started. And I think the research is going on to see what happens in the migrainer's brain after the headache goes away. So exactly 1 hour I have taken. So what is to take away from this talk? Well, look out for gadgets. That will be the future. I think in 15 to 20 years' time, we'll all be carrying out a gadget in our pocket. When we have a migraine, we'll probably put the gadget on our head, press the button, and we'll be migraine-free. So that's the thing to look out for future. For the near future, in the next 3 to 5 years, is the CGRP. Look out for CGRP antibodies. And there's a lot of research going on in imaging to see what exactly happens in the brain. We know what happens in the brain, but we still don't know why it happens in the brain, what causes people to have migraine. And look out for Ditans is another treatment which would be probably replacing the sumatriptan and zolmitriptan and all these triptans when the Ditans come out. So that's all for me. So thank you very much for your attention.